Sorry.
Hello, Sophie here. So in last week's video, I very quickly talked about turning meshes into 3D masks for grease pencil art. And so I thought now would be a good time to go into that in more detail, because this is a trick that I've pretty much used in all of my 3D pieces to date, and I just think it's so cool. So for this video, I'm gonna pull out an old piece, the very first project for which I tried to use 3D masks, and kind of failed. I kind of got it to work, but not how I wanted it to, and not very efficiently. But I've since figured out an awesome solution, and this is my redemption. So yeah, I've taken my old blend file from the Breath of the Wild fan art I made about the Karak forest, and then I just cleaned it up a bit so that we could just focus on the actual 3D mask part of it. So as you can see, I already have my camera set up. So it's just set to rotate 360 degrees around the object. I did this by creating an empty, which as you can see, I named Turn. I parented the camera to the empty, and then I just gave the empty two keyframes at the start and end, which were 360 degrees apart along the Z axis. So our mission today, to contain these two color layers within the shape of the Karak, so that they act as fill layers. As you can see, we have this layer that was drawn on a 2D plane, and then we have this layer that was drawn on the surface of the mesh, because before doing anything 3D in grease pencil, I like to start with a mesh and do some very, very simple sculpting. So as you can see, these strokes follow the shape of the Karak. And when we're in camera view, they rotate with the object, but as you can see, they still go past the form, which is not what we want. We have our line art, and basically what we want is for the colors to stay within the lines. And so we want to do this by creating a mask. But here's the challenge. We can't just draw an outline around the shape, fill it, and use that as our mask, because we also want this mask to follow the shape of the Karak as our camera rotates around it. A sort of living fill layer, as I like to call it. And no, we will not be drawing 360 different fill outlines. So we have our grease pencil object, and we have our mesh. We'll start by giving our mesh a few modifiers. So let's select our mesh and press Ctrl A and hit Apply All Transforms. This is just good practice and can prevent a lot of funny things from happening. Then we can go into the modifier section, the blue wrench icon, and we'll add a solidify modifier. We'll give it an offset of 1. We'll set the thickness to between 0.2 to 0.4. And then next to rim, check the box that says only rim. I'll explain the purpose of these modifiers in a bit, but one final note is just to make sure to not ever apply these modifiers. Next, we're going to add a decimate modifier. So we currently have 31,744 faces. So if we want Blender to not crash, we seriously need to get that number down. I try to go as low as possible while still having the form read decently well. That is too far. You can hold Shift to make the slider go a bit more slowly. 890. We're happy with that. So now what we want to do is, with our object selected, hit F3, search Convert, and then select Convert to Grease Pencil. Let's open up this little box and have a look. We'll check the box that says Keep Original, because we want to keep our mesh. And it all looks good. So before we go any further, I just want to address a small bug that has given me countless headaches. I should probably report it so it gets fixed, but alas. So we have our grease pencil object we created from our mesh. It's just called G Pencil. If we select it and go into the object data properties, we can see that it has two layers, one for the lines and one for the fills. I'll just hide this mesh for now so that we can see. And then if we go into the material properties, we also see that it has one material for the strokes and one material for the fill. But let's say, down the line, as you keep working on your project, you go back to your mesh and decide to make some changes. No problem. Creating a new 3D fill mask is as easy as deleting this grease pencil object, selecting our mesh, and repeating this step. Except this. This just made my file incredibly slow. And, as I discovered, trying to delete nearly 1,000 materials from your file, not fun. So let's undo the heck out of that. So there are two really easy ways to avoid this. One, and the easiest, would just be to rename your mesh. You could also go into your Blender file, up here, open the drop-down of the materials, and just select and delete the materials that are from the first time you converted the mesh into a grease pencil object. And then we can go back into our scene, and without needing to rename it, it will work. Perfect. So now, with the grease pencil object we made from our mesh selected, we can go once again into Object Data Properties, where we have our layers, and then we can select the fill layer, and in this drop-down menu, select Copy Layer to Object, and move it to our main grease pencil object. And it looks terrible. Don't mind the color change, that's just because I have a hue saturation modifier. But no, this is not what we want. So this is because it occupies the exact same 3D space as our object's mesh. So we can hide the grease pencil object we created. Don't want it anymore. And so I always like to keep my meshes, because like I've talked about before, they can be very useful to hide the strokes on the other side. But fear not, we have the solidify modifier. So now we can just select our mesh, go into the modifiers, and hide our solidify modifier. We also don't really need to keep the decimate modifier anymore, but we'll still keep them in case we make any changes to our mesh and need to very quickly update our 3D mask. So then we can select our main grease pencil object, go back into Object Data Properties, and we want to move this fill layer to the bottom. And then, because we're all super organized and always remember to rename our layers and objects and everything, we will quickly rename it to 3D Mask. This is definitely something I always remember to do. And then what we want to do is, selecting our mask layer, turn the opacity to 0. So now all we want to do is select our color layers, click this dot that says Mask Layer, and then in Masks, we can press the plus and then just search for our 3D mask layer. And we'll do the same thing for the other one. Ooh. And now we can see, as the camera rotates around the mesh, our fill layer follows the object and doesn't go beyond the line art. By the way, this 2D fill layer, I did this in the past, but it's parented to the camera, which is why, while the camera rotates around the object, that layer doesn't move. Then what I like to do is give the mesh a holdout material, and then I set this scene to transparent, and then presto! We have a 3D painting. So what I really like about this technique is that, if the strokes aren't fully opaque, as you can see, the paper texture shows through the drawing. Another cool thing about this trick is that I can create different effects with my fill layers. So for example, this piece, the 3D image looks like it was made from scribbly lines, and I think that's so cool. Those scribbly lines were actually drawn on a 2D layer, like the 2D plane that we have for our Karak, and I masked it in the same way. We can also see that effect in this piece. So it's also possible to do this with an animation, but it's very tricky. I actually just tried it again for this video, and it was not great. So I'll just quickly explain for those of you who are daring, but try it at your own risk. So I've only ever used this for this one piece, this evolution. Honestly, the hardest part of this was animating the grease pencil strokes to transform. which I did using the sculpt tools and the interpolation tool.
You don't have to lie in the sun, you know. Portway. Portway. Hi, you. Good boy. Champ, you wanna say hi? Hello.
But basically, I have my meshes, and the only difference is that they have shape keys, which I animated over about 60 frames. You can see the slider go as I scrub along the timeline. The location and scale are also animated. So then all you want to do is select your mesh, and then while you're in object mode, press the object button up here, and then select animation, and then select bake mesh to grease pencil. And then we're going to create a new object, and then you can just select which frames contain the animation. And then the only other thing you want to do is down here in projection type, select no reproject. And then you just pray that you decimated it enough and that your computer can handle it. I'd say, once again, if you are crazy enough to try this, give your computer like 2 to 10 minutes, depending on the number of faces you have and the length of your animation. If you click on your window and it says not responding, fear not. It's still doing its thing, it's just very slow. But I mean, when it does work, it's a really cool effect. And like, even in this one, you can still see those sketchy lines dancing around. And kind of like I said, I feel like this really gives an effect that I've never really seen before. Like, magical drawings, magical paintings. And that's just one of the things that really excites me about being an illustrator who found Blender. But yes, that being said, I don't think I will ever use this particular trick again. The 3D masks, absolutely. Like I said, I use that for all of my pieces. All of my pieces that have 3D. So I hope that was helpful. As always, liking and subscribing is a big help to this channel. You can find me everywhere at Sophie Jantak. And I will see you very soon. Bye. Good boy. Tame the animation.